In the previous video, we considered which 18th dynasty pharaoh was most likely to be the pharaoh of the Exodus. I concluded with two possibilities. If the pharaoh's body was recovered, then my pick for the pharaoh of the Exodus is Thutmose IV. If the pharaoh's body was lost during the sea crossing, then I would suggest that a ruling intermediary during the early years of Amenhotep III's reign was the pharaoh of the Exodus. I favor the former idea because the latter relies on speculation. However, I don't believe the latter can be ruled out due to the possibility that the pharaoh's body was lost in the sea. For the purposes of organizing a timeline, I will regard the Exodus as the event that resulted in the death of Thutmose IV. With this recognition, we can propose a timeline of events for the sojourn of the Israelites in Egypt through the beginning of the time of the judges. The next question then becomes, who was the pharaoh who oppressed the Israelites? In order to offer a proposal, I first need to refer back to an earlier video I produced about the length of the sojourn. For reasons that I covered in that video, I favor the Septuagint's reading of Exodus chapter 12, verse 40, that the Israelites spent 430 years in Egypt and in Canaan. Thus, this 430-year period refers to the calling of Abraham in Genesis 12 through the giving of the Mosaic Law at Mount Sinai. The result of this is that the time period of the Israelites in Egypt should be understood as roughly 215 years, with a portion of that time being a time flourishing in Goshen, and the remainder as the time of oppression. Genesis chapter 15 verse 16 describes the length of the oppression as, quote, 4 generations. Assuming a Bronze Age generation to be between 20 and 40 years, this would be a time period of 80 to 160 years, somewhere around half to two-thirds of the total sojourn period. When we attempt to identify the pharaoh of the Israelite oppression, this means we are looking for a figure who existed in this length of time prior to the Exodus. Using the end of the reign of Thutmose IV as our starting point, approximately 1400 BC, 80 to 160 years prior would point us to 1480 to 1560 BC as the beginning of the oppression period. The upper end of this scale happens to coincide well with the end of the second intermediate period and the beginning of the 18th dynasty. A little bit of historical background of this time period reveals some interesting circumstances relative to the Bible's testimony. Egypt during the second intermediate period was divided between northern and southern rulers. Dynasties 16 and 17 ruled out of the southern capital of Thebes, modern Luxor. Meanwhile, the north was ruled by dynasties 14 and 15, known to students of Egyptology as the Hyksos. The Hyksos are famous for being ruling dynasties of Semitic-speaking people, whose ancestors likely migrated down from Canaan and Syria during the Middle Kingdom. The collapse of the Middle Kingdom saw a prominent group of these Semitic people acquiesce power in the north out of their capital city, Avaris. The Hyksos dynasties ruled for around 150 to 200 years. Considering a roughly 1400 BC date for the Exodus, this would mean that Joseph would have come to power in the court of one of these Hyksos rulers. There are a lot of things that prove very attractive by locating Joseph and the migration of the Israelites to Goshen during the Hyksos period. But there are also those who raise objections to this. We will look at Joseph in a separate video. For now, I ask that you would please humor this timeline. The latter portion of Hyksos' rule saw warfare with the 17th dynasty kings, the native Egyptian rulers from Thebes in the south. The conclusion of this conflict saw the Hyksos rulers expelled from Egypt entirely by a man named Ahmose I. Ahmose would reunify Egypt under a single pharaoh, thus establishing the 18th dynasty. The reign of Ahmose is typically thought to have begun around 1550 BC. His ascension to the throne fits within the upper end of the scale for the period of oppression. Probably as a reaction to the animosity between himself and the Hyksos rulers, Ahmose begins revenge campaigns into Canaan and Syria. It doesn't appear that Ahmose was interested in annexing territory, rather that he was interested only in destroying any remaining Hyksos holdings in the Levant. One thing he does do, though, is bring back captives into slavery in Egypt. This policy would be furthered by the successive pharaohs of the 18th dynasty, who continually raided the Canaanite hill country for slave labor. Some Egyptologists have interpreted these actions as being rooted in a reactionary type of anti-Semitism, the result of the embarrassment of Lower Egypt having been ruled by Semitic peoples, whom the Egyptians referred to as Asiatics, for so long. It's entirely reasonable to conclude that any Semitic people who remained in or around Goshen after the expulsion of the Hyksos would have been made liable to this type of treatment as well, Egypt not wanting to allow any possibility for foreign rule again. If we overlay this with the testimony of Exodus chapter 1, a few things stand out immediately. First, if Joseph rose to power in the court of a Hyksos king, then it is unlikely that Ahmose would, quote, know of him. The Hebrew of know in verse 8 is yada. Two possible interpretations of this verse arise. Number one, the Pharaoh did not know about Joseph. Or number two, the Pharaoh did not regard or respect Joseph. Ahmose is a good candidate for either interpretation. If Joseph was in power about 75 to 100 years before Ahmose in the north, he may very well have not known who he was. If Ahmose did know who Joseph was, then it's likely that he would have no respect for him or the things he did for the Hyksos rulers. Second, the combination of Ahmose's vengeful attitudes with his paranoia over Egyptian sovereignty could very easily have led him to issue a decree similar to that recorded in verses 9 and 10. Finally, verse 11 describes the cities that the Israelites were put into forced labor to build as store cities. In other words, these weren't cities that were populated by common citizens. They were established for the purpose of storing goods and raw materials. Subsequent to his overthrow of the Hyksos, Ahmose largely depopulated their former capital city, Avaris. He did, however, initiate the building of, quote, enormous storage facilities, among them numerous silos, end quote, probably as a launch pad for Egyptian military expeditions into the Levant. Before this, Avaris was a metropolitan area, densely populated with Hyksos aristocracy. If Ramses in Exodus 1:11 is a redacted place name for Avaris, as we have previously proposed, then this becomes another synchronism we can use to link the biblical timeline with Egyptian chronology. Some alternative candidates present themselves in the form of Ahmose's two successors, Amenhotep I and Thutmose I. Amenhotep I probably still being close enough to the Hyksos expulsion to have held on to the same hostilities as his father. Thutmose I being the first 18th dynasty pharaoh who aspired to Egyptian hegemony over the Levant. Still, I find Ahmose to be the most likely. Though he lies toward the upper end of the scale for the beginning of the oppression period, many circumstances of his reign accord well with the Bible's testimony. Now that we have proposed a pharaoh of the Exodus and a pharaoh of the oppression, we can propose an overall timeline of events from Israel's migration into Goshen through the conquest of the Promised Land under Joshua. We will do so in the next video. Please subscribe and click the notification bell so that you will be notified when I release the upcoming videos in this series. For further reading on this subject, I recommend Let My People Go by Stephen Collins. You will find a link to this book in the description.